we decided to just juggle it. We're gonna be juggling it. So if you know you wanna be part of it, we just know that we're gonna be coming every day, but we cannot pinpoint any time. So the way it's going is just feel free to ask any questions when we go deep into it. Now what we're doing today, we're live on Facebook and we're live on Instagram, but we're recording it for YouTube. So far we have our 3 days on YouTube. So if you want to, you know, catch up with what we've said so far, you can always go on YouTube, Water Braiding, and see what we've done so far. So I am super excited about this because seriously, it's making a lot of sense to my life so far. And I know that by the time I'm done with this book, it's gonna be just a different level. And I'll tell you why I'm super excited or what's been happening. I'd like to hear your take so far if you've been following us. I like to hear what you have made out of what we've done so far. For me, the important messages or the lessons I've picked out so far, I'm picking out some of the things that's really picked out in my, you know, come out in my head. He says, it all starts with God. And we were born by His purpose and for His purpose. There are hundreds of circumstances, values and emotions that can drive your life. So this is about the ones, what's driving our life. And he explains that there are so many things that can drive you into action. It could be a problem, it could be a pressure, it could be a deadline, it could be a painful memory, it could be a haunting fear, it could be an unconscious belief. All these things affect us and, you know, pushes us sometimes in the right direction and sometimes in the wrong direction. But what he's reminding us is real security in life can only be found in that which can never be taken from us. And that's by the relationship we have with God. So we all need to remember that. And we're going to really come to that when we go into chapter 4 today. And it says, real life has meaning. Or when life has meaning, you can bear almost anything. So meaning now is always talking about us. So when life has meaning, you can bear almost anything. Without it, nothing is bearable. Hope is as essential to your life as air and water. So we all do need hope in order to cope with life and survive. You need hope to cope. And hope comes from having a purpose. So you can only have hope if you know what your purpose is. He says, without clear purpose, you have no foundation on which to base your decisions. Now, this is really, really touching me because after I do the program today, when I'm going to sleep, then I reflect on all the things we've talked about, and then it makes a lot of sense to me. It says, without clear purpose, you have no foundation on which to base your decisions. So this is a big one. What do you base your decisions on if you don't have a clear purpose? What do you allocate your time to if you don't have a clear purpose? And what do you use your resources on if you don't have a clear purpose? So these are such amazing things because now it made me look back into myself to say, yeah, this is very true. Where am I sending my resources? Where am I sending my time? And this is one of them. This is me sitting down here chatting with you about this book, but that's my time. So if it's not making any sense though, what I'm hoping to achieve, which is sharing this message with you, then is it what me taking it on? So these are the kind of things you need to start doing with yourself. Your purpose will help you decide what you base decisions on. It will help you allocate your time and it will help you use your resources properly. You make choices based on circumstances and pressures. And he says you make choices based on circumstances, and this is when you don't have a purpose. You would just make a choice based on, oh, this circumstance states I should do this. You also make your decisions without purpose. You make decisions based on circumstances, you make decisions based on pressures, and you make decisions based on your mood at the time. So this is really trying to hold us down to really know what we're doing with our time. It's helping us to be more organized. He said, without purpose, sometimes you do too much And I fall into that. I'm definitely one of that. If you've been watching my videos on YouTube, it's just endless. Ideas come constantly to me and I just want to implement them. So you do too much and this causes stress. So if I'm not organized about the things I'm doing, I see myself all over the place. It says it causes fatigue and it leads to conflict. And if you can't get it all done, it means you're trying too much. So when you've amassed all these things into your, you know, onto yourself to do and you can't get it all done, you're trying to do too much. And by doing that, you're doing more than God intended for you. This is why it is stressful. This is why you feel fatigued. So this is giving us really, really clear messages on what to do. He said, a life driven by purpose leads to a simpler lifestyle. This is the big message that's coming out of this. And a saner schedule. So if you have a clear purpose, your schedule is more sane. You have a simpler lifestyle. And the Bible says, a pretentious, showy life is an empty life. So when you attract so much to keep doing, all you're doing is you're just empty because you're not really going anywhere in particular. And a plain and simple life is a full life. So we'll get to understand this a lot more as we progress in the book. He says, knowing your purpose focuses your life. That really made more sense. So much sense to me. It focuses it. It concentrates your effort and energy on what's important. You become effective by being selective. That is an amazing statement, and that's something you really need to note down. Because knowing your purpose tells you, this is what I want to do today, this is why I'm doing what I'm doing, and your effort is concentrated, and your energy is spot on. And it's important that you become effective, because by that, you become selective. You know exactly what to pick up, what not to do. It goes further to explain, it is human nature, and this is just us as humans, to get distracted by minor issues. So minor things take our attention. We play trivial pursuits with our lives. And it quotes that Henry David Thoreau calls it quiet desperation. So we're quietly just getting by. Or he calls it aimless distraction. So that's what we're doing. And he explains, he says, just like a gyroscope, it's just spinning around at a frantic pace, but it's never getting anywhere. So that's what's happening to us. And that's why it's so amazing that we picked this book to read, because we want to get a meaning out of our life. We want to get a purpose. And if you want your life to have impact, he says we should focus it. Do only that which matters most. Never confuse activity for productivity. So if you are actively all over the place, and to you, you've done so much today, it doesn't necessarily mean you've been productive. Hello, Nadia, thank you. Thank you for coming along, and we're really looking forward to hearing all the questions that you're gonna be asking as we get along today. Do only that which matters most to you, and never confuse activity with productivity. And Paul said, let's keep focused on that goal. Those of us who want everything God has for us means we should just stay focused on that goal. Another interesting one too was, knowing your purpose simplifies your life. So if you know exactly what you want to do, it makes your life simple. It defines what you do and what you don't do. This is really exciting as well. Purpose becomes the standard you use to evaluate which activities are essential and which activities are not. So you have to ask yourself, does this activity help me fulfill one of God's purpose for my life? So these are just the little lessons I've taken on that I've picked up so far and that has made sense to me. And so I'm really, really gearing and excited. Today we're going to hop into what chapter 4 is all about. And before I go into chapter 4, this is something interesting that happened today. A friend of mine popped around to say hi to me because she hasn't seen me for a long time. And I said, well, you know me, I'm everywhere busy doing things. And she told me an interesting story, because I'm telling this story because it's going to connect with what we're going to talk about today, chapter 4. And so a friend of hers, she met the lady not too long, and then she traveled and went somewhere else, and by the time she came back to this place where this lady was, she only heard that the lady had died. She was involved in an accident and had died, and this was a huge shock to her because it wasn't long she left the place. And so it just reminds us how short our life is on this earth. And that's the topic today. The topic is called Made to Last Forever. And so, as usual, what I'll do, I'll read out the scribbles that I've taken out from reading that chapter, and then we'll chat about it. So if you're just coming on, this is the book we're reading, Rick Warren, The Purpose Driven Life, and we're trying to understand what our purpose is. But a quick one before I even go there, there was something else I scribbled which was quite interesting, and I needed to share that with you. It's coming from this book, Walking with the Law, and this is another favorite book that I love so much. I haven't really read it as well, but little snippets. I got to know about this book from a man called Bob Proctor on YouTube, and he's one of the people I really love listening to his messages about caring for yourself and motivating yourself. Bob Proctor talks about that book a lot, and I got really excited. So what I do is, once I'm watching something or I'm reading something and they mention a book, I quickly go and buy it. And if you're coming for the first time, you'll find that the whole of this table, I got all kinds of personal development books which are all there to help me times when I'm low. And again, if you haven't been following us, this whole idea came from me being really, really, really low. And I reminded myself that I have a book that really tries to explain what life is all about, or why we're here on earth, which is the question that he asks. He said, why on earth am I here? So that's why I chose that book, for us to read it together. And then watching another man called Gary Vee, and one of the best things he said was, record every moment, or document every moment. And so I decided, let me read this book with you guys so that we can all learn something from it together. Also to help the younger generations who think that life is just an easy race. And what happens is, the minute something happens, they break down very quickly. So someone like me, once things are not going the way I'm hoping, I delve back into books that are helping to you know, inspire me up or strengthen me again. So Walking with the Law, this was something I picked up, really exciting. It says, while others, including great Greek dramatists, always saw the causes in some external fate or destiny that brought about the downfall of their characters. So these are dramatists, and whenever they are trying to act a role or something, they always thought that what causes the problem is from some external sources. It says, Shakespeare, who is the leading dramatist of the world, saw something within the man as the cause of his failure or success. So other people, and when I read that, it made me laugh, because I'd explained, I think it was in chapter one, where I'm African, and generally in Nigeria, that's just our culture. If anything happens to anybody around you, you automatically think it's somebody. It's always somebody's fault. If someone has headache, it's somebody's fault. If someone has, you know, anything happens to anybody, somebody else is responsible. So these dramatists are saying the same thing, and they are Greek philosophers. But this man, Raymond Holloway, says no. Yeah. He found it so exciting because Shakespeare said it in another way. He said, the fault, dear Brutus, if you were one of the Shakespearean scholars, you probably, I don't know which particular book this one came from, but he just explained it. He said, the fault, dear Brutus, is not in our stars, but in ourselves, that we are underlings. So, explaining it, the fault, whatever it is that happens to us. I know I tried to comment out the one of the days where I said, we are not our bank account. And somebody was asking me, I should explain. our bank account, whatever is happening there, or our exam results, or the life we have right now, one way or the other, we cost it. So whatever scenario we find ourselves in, we may have attracted it one way or the other without knowing. So that's what is happening here. The fault, dear Brutus, is not in our stars. So whatever it is that's causing our issues is not in our stars. It's not in other people, as the other Greek philosophers were thinking. The fault is in ourselves. So it's either our inactivity or something we did that we shouldn't have done. One way or the other, whatever it is, always is within us. And that's one of the things that this book is really opening to me, which I am so excited because I'm beginning to pick it. I'm beginning to look back into myself. I'm beginning to look around me and understanding the things that are causing the issues that are affecting me. He says, one of them says, there is a marvelous inner world that exists within man. And that really touched me. So there's an inner person inside us. And the revelation of such world enables man to attain and to achieve anything he desires within the bounds of limits of nature. So there's this inner world inside you. And he explains a bit further, but maybe by the time I'm done with this, I'll be able to carry that on, but I don't know yet. I'll focus on this 40 days first. He says, everything that's happening to us comes from inside. Now think about it. Every invention that's ever been made on this earth came from somebody's idea. Some person woke up one bright morning or evening or whatever time and came up with an idea. Boom, why don't I do this? And then they put it into action. So that explains why in all of us there is a person. There's a person in all of us. And so that person needs to be brought out in the open. That person needs to be brought out in the open. So you are the master of your circumstance. Call forth your power. Initiative, ingenuity, and be the master. Be that person that you are. Faith is in your hands, and you have to determine it. Working with the law. And it all adds up to all we're looking at in this amazing book, Purpose Driven Life. So now we're actually on to chapter 4, Made to Last Forever. So the first thing it says is, surely God would not have created such a being as man to exist only for a day. No. Man was made for immortality. And who said that? Abraham Lincoln. So the story I was telling you about my friend whose friend died, just added that on. We were made for last forever. And he explains. He says, surely God would not have created such a being. This is Abraham Lincoln. So he's wondering, we were made for immortality. Okay, so this life is not all there is. What we have right now is not all there is. That's what this man is explaining. This life is preparation for the next life. And that, wow, is really something to think about. He explains, he says, at most, you will live 100 years. At most of us here will live for 100 years. And this really touched me because I read a passage in the Bible before that explained, and this was Psalm 90, verses 10 to 14. It says, we will live up to 70 years or 80 years when our strength can carry us. That is the average person. We're not talking about people who die young and, you know, due to unnatural causes. But the regular natural cause when nature has come to strike, 70 and maybe 80 when our strength can carry us. And this book says at most 100 years. So most times when you look at people who really beat that, you're looking at 100. I was watching YouTube and I'm thinking, you know, something about this oldest person was 114. So we should be aware of that. But we're going to spend forever in eternity. So this particular chapter for me is taking us really deeper into understanding what's behind who we are right now. And it says, but you will spend forever in eternity because you were made to last forever. That's the title, Made to Last Forever. So the Bible says God has planned eternity in the human heart. And that's why most times we have an inborn instinct that longs for immortality. This is because God designed us in that image, in His own image, to live for eternity. Even though we know everyone eventually dies, like the story we heard earlier, death always seems unnatural to us and unfair. And so whenever you hear somebody die, even when they are 80, 90, we still cry, we still get upset, we still wonder why has this person gone? And it says the reason we do that is because we feel we were meant to last forever. But the sad thing is, one day our heart will stop beating. And this is all of us. One day our heart will stop beating. And that will be the end of our body on this earth. But it will not be the end of who we are. So this is where we need to start questioning now, where are we going with this? And what does he mean by that? He says your earthly body is just a temporary residence for your spirit. And so this body that's moving around, that's going to last 80 to 100, is a temporary body for the spirit. And it says the Bible calls the earthly body a tent. So what we are using now to, you know, me sitting out here chatting with you, the physical form you're seeing, is a tent. The Bible calls it a tent. But the future body, he calls it a house. So when this tent we live in, which is the body, our body here on earth, is torn down, God will have a house in heaven for us to live in, a home he himself has made, which will then last forever. Okay, so you and I, we're still here. We don't know what that means. We don't know how that's going to happen. But what we know is that none of us are going to be here forever. But God has planned eternity in the human heart. God has inborn instinct in us that wishes to live forever, even though we know all of us are going to die. He said, one day our heart, we read that one, and then he says, while on earth offers many choices, eternity offers only two. So while we're here on earth, we have so many choices of what to do. But when we die, we have only two choices. And he calls that heaven and hell. So this is when you get further and further into religious undertow. But that's for us to wonder. But for sure, one thing we know is we're not going to be here forever. He said, your relationship with God on earth will determine your relationship with him in eternity. And there are two kinds of people. Those who say to God, let thy will be done. So as you're just moving around your regular purpose in life, you're saying to God, please take care of this thing. Bring your will in me here on this earth. Let it be your will. Let it not be mine. And there are those that God says to them, all right then, have it your own way. And this is the question we're asking in this book, Purpose-Driven Life. What purpose am I here for? And that's the question I want all of us to actually ask each other. When you fully comprehend that there is more to life than just here and now, you realize that life is just preparation for eternity. And so while we're going around our daily activities and we're, you know, gyrating and spinning in this one spot, wondering what next to do, or with amassing so much and getting all stressed and fatigued and, you know, harassed, once we understand that life is not just what we're seeing now, we'll probably start to think again. We'll probably start to appreciate what life is about. And so you start living in light of eternity. And that will color how you handle every relationship, every task that you take on, every circumstance that you take on. Suddenly, many activities and goals and problems that seem so important will start to appear trivial. They will start to appear petty, and they will start appearing unworthy of your attention. So this is a big message for us. The minute we start understanding that this physical being that we're seeing here and all the craziness that we deal with, I want to have 50 houses across the world. I want to travel to everyone. Nothing is wrong with it. I mean, I love traveling because it's all about education. I want my bank account to be full to the brim. I want. That's us human beings. We're constantly wanting the next thing and wanting bigger and larger, and we want to compete with everyone around us, and we start to be envious and so jealous of each other, and we don't want to support each other and be there for other people. Once we know that our being here is a temporary thing, we will start looking at these things again in a different light. We start looking back and say, but why? Because if someone you knew maybe a week ago or 2 weeks ago, suddenly boom, you hear the person is gone, then you ask yourself, why? Where has that person gone to? And all the stress this person was going through, was it necessary? Everything else will appear. And when you live in light of eternity, your values will change. You will now start appreciating things in a different way. And that's why I'm so excited coming here, reading this book with you. Again, to share the understanding I have about this book with you, but of course to help other people who I know. I'm not even going to be thinking, let me go and buy a book and start reading. Or maybe even when they do, may probably understand it in another way. So it's important that we start thinking of other people as well at all times, and take away the me that we generally do as humans, and then forget that everything we're going through here is temporary. You will use time and money more wisely. Remember, we talked about how once you begin to understand your reason for being here, you have meaning. You can bear almost anything without it. Nothing is bearable. And we've said that you make choices based on circumstances normally when things are not right. But once you have a purpose, you have no foundation on which you base, then you have a foundation to base your decisions. Then you know how to allocate your time and you know how to use your resources. That's what this is trying to explain to us. Because you use your time wisely. And you use the resources available to you wisely. I mean, I put this home training pack that we have, trying to train people across the world. That's my dream, to share this knowledge that I have, this skill that I have about how to work with hair. I have it all in a box. And this box has over, how many DVDs? I think we have over 30 DVDs in this pack, where 20 of them are practical, hands-on. By the time you're done with this home pack, you have all the skill you need. And we've had people calling us from all over the US asking us, so when I finish our training, which we have confirmed there will be a certificate attached to it, all you do is send us images of your work. We look at it, yes, you've done amazing work. Lots of people who have bought this DVD and train at home are doing amazing things. But we still get people asking, will you give me license to operate? Now, for me, the most important thing is you give yourself a skill. That's my big dream and vision for people across the world. Because I was in that position where I lost my corporate job and I had children to feed. And I wondered what I was going to do. And I had to hop into the plane and travel to various parts of the world to gain training. And I realized that if I had anyone give me a packaged home training, I would not have had to do all that. And so that's my contribution to women across the world. That's my contribution to help as many people as possible who cannot deal with staying in a hotel, paying all that money to travel the world to come to me, and all the feeding and unnecessary experiences of being in a new location. So that's how I contribute to life. And that's what it is. You'll be able to allocate your resources in the right place once you know what your purpose is in life. And so all this keeping up with the trends and amassing wealth and making sure it's the best iPhone, the latest iPhone, and the latest cars, and wearing the latest watch, or what's that wristwatch again? I keep it comes and goes, and I can't remember what that watch is called again.
Rolex.
Making sure, I mean, I read a story the other day, it was very funny, and this was on WhatsApp, and this particular man, he's from Nigeria, it was a story from Nigeria, and there was an accident. So this man had this expensive car, very expensive car, and he had an accident. So he was now screaming and getting, you know, when there's an accident, he was very upset, someone smashed into his car, and this is him getting really frantic and very angry because he's expensive. I looked at his hand and said, oh no, I've lost my Rolex. That was something, because the man is not interested in his hand had been cut off. All he wanted to know was his Rolex had disappeared. Obviously, being with the accident, Rolex had gone, who knows where it is. So that's how materialistic some people are. So keeping up with all of this comes to nothing when you realize that all you're here for is a temporary stay. Eternity is our funerals. You may feel it is morbid to think about death, but it is unhealthy to live in denial of death. That's what this author is trying to explain to us. And not consider what is inevitable. He says, only a fool will go through life unprepared for what we all know will eventually happen. And I don't know if it's Eckhart Tolle or one of them. This is another great person I listened to. They said, I think it was Bob Proctor, the law of opposites. For everything that's been born, there's an end. Even the Bible says in Ecclesiastes, it says there is time for everything. There is time for everything. A time to be born and a time to die. So this man is just reminding us that we need to appreciate who we are today. It's a temporary stage. It's a temporary thing. And so we shouldn't live life thinking we own ourselves. It will be the last hour of your time on earth. He says, it might be the last hour of your time on earth, that's when we die, but it won't be the last of you. It won't be the last. He said, rather than being the end of your life, it will be your birthday into eternal life. So as you're transiting, that's why you hear some people, they say transition. The Bible says the world is not our home. We are looking forward to our everlasting home in heaven. It is wise to live each day as if it were the last day of your life here. So each time you're doing all these activities and running around and chasing different things, just keep reminding yourself, you don't own yourself. You don't know what your purpose is. And that's why it says we should keep asking our Creator, this action we're taking, is it part of His purpose? I believe me sharing this message with you is part of my purpose. Because somehow I'm the kind of person that whatever I experience, I want to share it. And when Gary Vee mentioned documenting journey, I said, yes, you know, you're so right. I try to document journeys all the time. But that inspired me to decide that I was going to take on this 40-day journey. So Matthew Henry said, it ought to be the business of every day to prepare for our final day. Knowing what we know now, what should I stop doing? And what should I start doing today? So that's my question to everyone that's watching today. What should I start doing? And what should I stop doing? So, as usual, we normally have our green card. Not green card per se, but the little cards, I have them in different colors. And I write a few things in them. I didn't write much in this one today because I knew I was going to just talk about it. But it just says this life is not all there is, which we've gone through. So it's not all there is. There's more to our life. And there's more to who we are. And whatever this purpose is that God has sent us here for, it is down to us to try and find out what it is. And stop chasing around and gyrating, like this gyroscope, he calls it. I've never heard that word before. Spinning around in one spot and really getting nowhere fast. So once we can narrow down on the purpose, we stay more focused. And once we are focused, we will know what to do. We will know where to allocate our time. We will know where to allocate our resources. We know what to put our decisions on. So please share this message with your friends. And also invite your friends to come in whenever we say we're live on this. And let's share this message with each other so we start organizing our thoughts to a greater, better life. So I look forward to seeing you tomorrow, and God bless you eternally.